Thank you. So I will then call to order the regular meeting of the Brandon Planning Commission for Wednesday, August 5th, 2020. My apologies for that delay, but we'll move forward. First is a roll call, and I see all commissioners present except Commissioner Hill, who sent her regrets. So it's good. I have an agenda before us. Do I have a motion to adopt the agenda? Commissioner Boyd, Commissioner Anderson, all those in favor of adopting the agenda? That's carried. The minutes we've also received. Commissioners have had a chance to review it. Commissioner Anderson, you're moving to accept the minutes?
Yep.
And Commissioner Boyd is seconding that. Any revisions or corrections to the minutes?
Good.
Okay, not hearing any. All those in favor of confirming the minutes? Thank you. So now we move on to the public hearing portion. I will just briefly remind the audience of some of our protocols. So the purpose of the meeting is to ensure that all parties at the hearing have proper decorum and are able to present their views. And the applicant and any person making presentations at the hearing are given an opportunity to present those views to the commission. So we'll follow the agenda. Each item will be addressed in order. Members of the audience, during this, we ask you to turn off your phones and maintain order and quiet and not to interrupt the person or member of the commission who is speaking. First, we'll deal with, as each issue goes through, with the planning staff, then the applicant, then anyone in favor, anyone in opposition, and then anyone for information purposes. Please address your presentation through the chair and not anyone else in the gallery. When speakers are presenting, you state your name and allowing 5 minutes to speak on the item. If you have any questions from the commissioners, they can be raised through the chair. The administration and the applicant can have an opportunity at the end to answer any of those questions. I will go with that. Thank you.
Thank you, Andrew. Good evening, Mr. Chair. So first item tonight is for the East amendment to the East Brandon Industrial Area Secondary Plan. So the area outlined in yellow generally represents the area of where the East Brandon Industrial Area Secondary Plan applies. So we're looking at the Assiniboine River's north and eastern boundaries, followed by 17th Street East, southwards to Richmond Avenue East, then heads west to the Douglas Street right-of-way. And then the south side is the city limits slash Patricia Avenue East. So we are amending the secondary plan to allow for flexibility in implementation policies to enable some advanced development of the full service B area. Also, we are taking this opportunity to clean up some small errors here and there in the document itself. So this is the existing land use designation map in the secondary plan. We are not proposing any changes to the land use designations. But so I am putting this up to let you know that the what we call the full service area B, also known as FSB, is the area shown in pink in the map that you see before you. So the western boundary, the westernmost extent is just over the eastern bypass. Heading eastwards all the way past Maple Leaf Foods towards Connexus and the river, and flanking both sides of Richmond Avenue East when you head east of the Maple Leaf Foods plant. Okay, this the amendment includes an alternative servicing scenario. My apologies. So it will be a new Figure 5B, which is currently shown on the screen. This alternative servicing scenario supports water and wastewater servicing of this area, the FSB area, in the short term before the city makes long-term infrastructure improvements that would enable full build-out of the area. So currently, the secondary plan only identifies the city's long-term investments required to enable development, as there are significant infrastructure extensions and upgrades required. However, we recognized after we first adopted this secondary plan back in 2018 that we need to provide some flexibility just in case there's some interest in developing in parts of the FSB area. So we are anticipating two short-term options to use available capacity, but the network additions will still require significant cost. So the investment in the alternative servicing scenario, whichever one of those two would likely be triggered by developer interest in the area and potentially funded through private and public partnerships of some form. So with our analysis, we believe the proposed changes are still in compliance with the development plan. We are not changing the land use designations, as I said earlier. The developable areas are going to be industrial in nature. It is reflecting the city's needs to take the long-term approach in infrastructure investments to enable full build-out of the area. At the same time, we are proposing interim infrastructure improvements to make use of existing street rights-of-way and utility corridors, and we're allowing for part of the FSB area to be developed as a first stage of full build-out before the city does make those long-term infrastructure improvement commitments. So as of closing today, we did not receive any comments from the public on this application. Mr. Chair.
Thank you. The commissioners, do you have any questions for the administration? Not hearing any. That's great. Thank you very much. Do we have anybody in the audience that's going to be speaking in favor of this, since we don't really have an applicant, so the city's the applicant? Anybody speaking in opposition? Anybody seeking more information? No. All right. With that, then, I'd entertain a motion from a commissioner to conclude the public hearing. Commissioner Anderson?
That the public hearing for bylaw 7274 to amend secondary plan bylaw number 7209 East Brandon Industrial Area secondary plan be concluded.
And a seconder? And all those in favor of concluding the hearing? It's carried. Do I have a motion to recommend this change to council for approval?
Yeah, I can do that also.
Commissioner Anderson?
That the Planning Commission recommend City Council approve bylaw number 7274 to amend the East Brandon Industrial Area secondary plan number 7209.
The seconder for that motion, Commissioner Hobson. Any discussion?
I'll just comment that it enables direct development of the East Brandon Industrial Area and develops the city's industrial lands, makes it easier for them.
Anybody else?
I think just to add to that, it's clear, taking some typing errors that were in there and cleaning up some language in those areas, and it's making it favorable going through to present this, and we're looking at taking this forward to City Council so they put approval on that one. So we're for that.
Great. So I'll call the question, and all in favor? It's all four, thank you. So we will move along to item B, the 11 Dominion Way.
Thank you again, Mr. Chair. So the next application, yes, is for a conditional use application at 11 Dominion Way. This site is located in the west end of the city, a west central part, closer to the city limits, between the CP Railway and Victoria Avenue. And if we zoom in more closely, it is at the southeast corner of Premier Avenue and Dominion Way. Dominion Way is the north-south street you see there to the left of the site, highlighted in yellow. The area is mostly zoned residential single detached with some more moderate density housing closer to Victoria Avenue, as well as a school and park within 500 meters walking distance. So this site fronts onto Dominion Way and is the only house on the east side of that street on this block facing the street. The other property that does on this block that is adjacent on the east side of Dominion Way fronts onto the one of the cross streets there. Picture on the left of the four here shows the, how narrow domain way is, and on the right it shows the neighboring properties as well as the intersection of Premier and Dominion. The conditional use application is to allow for a home daycare of up to 12 children under the age of 12 in the residential single detached zone. Currently, the zoning bylaw permits only up to 8 children in a home daycare land use. So what they're asking for does require conditional use approval, which is what we do tonight. The applicant submitted a floor plan showing how the layout will be. So the basement will be only for personal space. The main floor will be used for the daycare as well as for personal use, with the daycare functions being, it looks like it's in the central part of the house you see there. And the second floor is all personal space for their own use as well. During the circulation of the application, the city identified parking and loading as a potential issue for the proposed use. These images on this slide, as well as the parking policy that the applicant provided, explained that the parking should not be an issue because of their wide driveway, as well as the fact that they are receiving that they are going to be accommodating families with multiple children wanting to patronize the daycare facility. So one vehicle will likely be carrying multiple children, or dropping off and picking up multiple children at one time. The applicant also mentioned that some families have expressed that they would walk their children to the daycare, so further mitigating the potential parking issues in this area. The reason why we brought up the parking as a potential concern is because, as I mentioned earlier, the street is pretty narrow. It only allows for one side parking, and it's just barely enough for two-way traffic when there is a car parked on one side. Furthermore, the applicant did provide a parking policy for their clients, outlining rules of drop-off and pickup that limit the time that people will be waiting in the driveway and therefore on this. So the proposed use should be compatible. As I said, that we did raise some potential parking and loading concerns, but based on what the applicant has put forward in terms of their proposal, we are not concerned at this time to raise objections. We do recommend, though, that we allow to revisit this approval in the future if we receive substantiated complaints about parking or traffic in this area because of this land use. Otherwise, this proposal, in our analysis, is a fit in the area. So the applicant did reach out to nearby property owners directly, and as of closing today, we did not receive any comments from the general public. Mr. Chair.
Thank you. My commissioners, do anyone have a question for Mr. Mock? I will then. Just, could you just clarify this? So eight children daycare would have just been a straight allowed, and the conditional use is to make it to extend it to 12? How does that?
Through the chair, yes. So 8 children are permitted under the zoning bylaw, and it would be just a permit through our office. And daycares are also regulated by the province as well, so they need provincial approval as well. The reason why 8 is the threshold is it's tied to the building code. The building code has provisions, again, limiting up to 8 children at any one time. You only reach a certain threshold for requirements under the building code. Once you go above that, there are certain improvements required as well. From a land use perspective, there is also more children involved potentially, and that's why we it's a condition used to make sure it's still an appropriate fit.
Good. So I was just curious why it wasn't a variation to the why it was a conditional use. That's good. Thank you. Any other questions now, Commissioner?
Through the chair. What about staff parking? Has that been addressed? Will there be staff hired?
Chair, to Commissioner Anderson, if I recall correctly, and the applicants can confirm, They themselves, they live at the residence, mm-hmm. and they are the only staff there, but I will let the applicants confirm that.
Thank you. We'll perhaps call on the applicant now to come forward and present, and then that will maybe answer a few more of our questions.
Outside staff, it will just be ourselves.
We can just get your names as well for the record.
Sure, I'm Dustin Van Dam. This is Megan Van Dam, my wife.
Welcome.
We just want to thank the Planning Commission for all of their work. They covered everything fairly well. We'll just take a moment.
We wanted to use the
So briefly, just about who we are. Megan's an early childhood educator. She's educated and licensed by the province at a level 2, so she is able to meet those provincial regulations to open home daycare that's licensed on the CCA. Like licensed by the province as well. I'm also a paramedic with the province with Shared Health for 14 years. Megan's got over a decade of experience at a large center with 80 children, so this is a bit of a breeze for her. This is interior views of the daycare proposal that we have. We're getting quite set up, ready to go. We've just in our 50 houses within 150-meter radius that we had to survey, we've already had almost 20 people interested. Oh. Spots starting as soon as September. So high need in the area. Everybody's very interested. We've got people looking 1 to 2 years in advance for spots. The opposite direction there. An exterior view. We have a fully fenced yard. We will only be using it for a small portion of the time. We do have a number of city parks within a 500 meter radius that we will utilize to do most of our outdoor time. That's more our fenced yard there. These are the city parks within walking distance. We also do have this buggy that's pictured here in the corner that seats multiple children. So two, 3, and 4 year olds that are slower at walking, we can whisk them along faster to those parks, and the older 4 and 5 year olds can walk along. Our experience at another center on 26th Street is that they do not have attached green space and have to walk about 4 blocks. So this is consistent with the standard that exists in the city. These are the parks in question, Fox Place, which is just 3 blocks away. Beautiful, huge park. For anybody in it, we would love to use it a lot of the time, as well as River Heights Park. And then on days where the school is closed, River Heights School, so we would use that obviously in the summertime. We can go there as well as PD days. Any questions? And that's our daughter there.
Thank you very much. Commissioners, any questions? Commissioner Boyd?
Yes, I guess the question that was brought up on the one that the city had concern on the one is the parking. You're looking at the one going forward where you're looking at a double driveway, you can park 4 vehicles in there. I think sort of the question coming forward from one of the commissioners was looking at, you have your own personal vehicles, so are those in the garage, or are they also in the park?
Right, so the camper's
in
not
the driveway, or how is that there? The
camper's not usually there, and we also put our one vehicle in the garage, so there's 4 potential spots in the driveway. One thing we do want to point out about the parking is, like we know this industry well, parents don't all come at the same time. Also, lots of siblings come in the same vehicle, mitigating that a little bit. We also have interest from within 3 or 4 houses down. We have 4 parents that are interested. So they're not going to deal with car seats for such a small distance. They're going to walk their children from their daycare rather than deal with strapping 2 or 3 children into a car to move them that direction. Further, our experience is at Magical Memories Daycare on 26th Street. They have 80 spots for their children. And they have 3 parking spots out front. All of their staff park on the street, and they handle those 3 spots quite well.
Thank you. Commissioner Anderson, did you have anything else to ask?
So you're not, through the chair, sorry. So you're not going to have backup staff just in case one of you...
Yes, we will have a sublist. They have to be fully approved by the province to have all of their checks, just like us, yes.
Yeah. Yeah. So then you'd have to accommodate their parking, supposedly.
Yes.
Yeah. Oh, another question through the chair. It says up to 12 children. That's including your own.
That
so
is,
how
yes.
many children do you have?
One.
One. Oh. Okay.
And that ratio will always include our own children. So as we have more children, that number of outside children will go down.
Good. Any other questions? Excellent. Thank you very much for coming out. Thank you for the proposal. We haven't received anybody in the audience that's looking to speak otherwise in favor or in opposition or seek questions, because I only have the one form. So if there are no other questions, could I entertain a motion to conclude the public hearing? Commissioner Boyd?
I do that. Make a motion that the conditional use applications C-03-20 at 11 Dominion Way be concluded.
05.
And a seconder for that, Commissioner Hobson. And all in favor of concluding the public hearing? So that's carried, and now we look for a motion regarding the conditional use.
I can do that as well.
For you.
Make a motion that the conditional use application C-05-20 to allow for a group daycare with 12 children under 12 years of age in the residential single detached zone be approved at 11 Dominion Way in accordance with a letter of intent attachment A, subject to the ongoing demand and function of on-street parking being generally consistent with the use in the RSD zone. If as a result of a neighbor complaint, the city verifies an injurious on-street parking impact, the chief planner will require the owner or successor to facilitate an alternate solution, or this approval will be revoked.
And a seconder for the motion, Commissioner Anderson. Commissioner Boyd, do you wish to speak to the motion further?
I think the applicants have done a lot of work. They have a lot of history in the in the field of child care. It's a good fit for the area. The accommodations are there. They've done a lot of work on that. And the only issue that seemed to be here at all was one that there may be a potential concern with parking, which I think they have addressed very, very adequately. So with that, I'll be looking to approve this application.
Excellent. Thank you. Commissioner Anderson?
Want to thank the applicants. It was a very good and detailed report that we had in our package, and so you did your homework, so that's good. I am in favor of this. We do need more daycare spaces here, and normally with daycares it is a drop-off pickup, and if there is an issue, I'm sure you will straighten it out and rectify it, because you want to keep the neighborhood happy. So that's all I have to say.
Ms. Hobson, do you have anything to add? Oh. All right, well then I'll call the question. All in favor of the conditional use? It's all four. Thank you. So you've got your conditional use.
Sure.
It's like a talk show. Oh, the list of guests. Come with the new guest. So we will move on to item C, the Westminster Drive, well, sorry, Winchester Drive application.
Mr.
Yes, no, I think.
Yes, Your Majesty.
I think I half read, I was going to say Winston Churchill for a second, but I tried to say it, but it didn't come out. So.
Okay, it is on the screen. Thank you again, Mr. Chair. And yes, so. This one is actually a variance application. Sorry, that should not be a C. That should be a V there. Right. Winchester Drive. So this is located, again, in the west central part of the city, right at the city limits there, south of Victoria Avenue this time. Looking at more closely, it is at the dead end part of Winchester Drive, which, as you can see, is right at the city limits there. The site is trapezoidal in shape due to the street's cul-de-sac design. So this is a view of the site from the front of the site, so in the circle, the cul-de-sac section of Winchester Drive. And this is viewed from the north side of the site. So what we're seeing here is the area where the garage addition is being proposed here, which is why we have the variance request to reduce the required front yard from 6 meters to 1.5 in the residential single detached zone. So this is the site plan showing the so the grayed out area. Let me turn on the laser pointer here. So the grayed out area is the part of the existing house on the site. So this white area here is where the proposed addition is going to be. That the anyways. Forward, and I'm trying to. In the meantime, I can tell you that the current front yard of the site is 6.8 meters, so again, measured from the curved portion of their site. There is an existing utility easement that is 4.6 meters wide along the front yard, and that is measured from that property line inwards into their property. Okay, I can move it forward again. So these are just elevations showing how the house looks like with the addition proposed. So the garage addition itself is single story in nature. So the site, in our analysis, we know that the site is located in a residential area where there are double and triple wide attached garages, as they are a significant building form in this area. Though this proposal makes the building form larger than the typical ones you see in this area, considering the site's shape and the driveway approach width at the curb not changing, the proposal will not have an overwhelming appearance here. Though the total number of five garage bays is not typical in the area, given that there are no dwellings immediately adjacent to the proposed garage addition, the impact of the garage's decreased front yard on neighboring properties should be minimal. Due to the limited space for the structure at the site's northwest corner, the proposed garage addition significantly reduces the front yard. And though there's no injurious effect of the zoning bylaw on the site, this decrease is the minimal modification necessary to allow for this structure there. Otherwise, the proposal is consistent with all other applicable provisions of the development plan and the zoning bylaw. We are recommending a condition be on this application if the Planning Commission wishes to approve it, and that is to provide for the owner or successor to provide written confirmation that arrangements have been made for existing utility easements relocation, all costs associated with that being the owner's responsibility.
Okay.
So as I mentioned earlier, the typical easement in a newer urban residential neighborhood is 4.6 meters. So they need to make sure that they address the utilities concerns for reduced easement. And as of closing today, we did not receive any correspondence from the public. Mr. Chair.
Thank you. Commissioners, do you have any questions at this time?
Hear from the applicant.
Sure. Thank you. So we'll call up the applicant or their representatives.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Planning Commission, my name is Steve McMillan. I'm here on behalf of the J&G Group, who's here on behalf of Vinyl Jacobson and Robin Jacobson. They're the owners of the home. So, I mean, it's pretty straightforward. Andrew has gone through that they're looking to do an addition for another two garage spaces. Just a point of clarification, I know they say that it's going to be a total of five. It is going to be a total of four. The third one on the back end is more or less a man door. The stairs are kind of right in front of it, so no vehicle can fit in. It's just more or less, I think, to for kids, for the bikes and,
oh, okay.
and garbage containers, but they have an entryway into the house through there with stairs that block off that area. So it would be four. So if you've driven around, there are some houses that have triple car garages. It seems to be, I mean, more and more
popular
on newer builds as well. So but yeah, four is a little out of the ordinary, but the house is a little out of the ordinary as well. So it fits the scale of the home. I actually live on the street, and it's not going to look out of place. We've talked in the neighborhood, and no one really has an issue with it. So really, it's one of the first times I don't really have a lot to add. If there's any questions that anyone has, I can answer them, but I'll just kind of leave it with what Andrew put. I guess the only thing is there is no issue with the condition. So we have been working with Manitoba Hydro for the past 6 to 8 weeks. If anyone's dealt with Manitoba Hydro, it does take a long time to get things kind of through their processes. So it may be a few months before they actually design how they're gonna reroute the services. Because it's just the one corner of the garage is within that easement, but from the street you would have no idea that the addition would be out of place, because there's still going to be over 20 feet to the back of the curb. But yeah, I can answer any questions if you have them.
Commissioners?
That was going to be, through the chair, that was going to be my only question of how dealings were going with the Manitoba Hydro and the utilities going through with the changes of the easement on there. So, but if those accommodations can be met, then it's the main condition of that's been put up by the Planning Commission. So yeah.
Through the chair, we had received confirmation from the head of development services that if they require to move any utilities on the city portion of the property line, that would be allowable. I think they're trying to still allow it within the property, maybe along the property line, but then would allow an additional easement on the city portion if they have to dig anything up. But the city's allowed that option, so I think that'll help with rerouting any utilities. It is also a slab, so there is the option you could build over it, but I know they don't usually like to do that.
Any other questions then? Great, thank you very much.
Okay, thank you.
Do we have anybody else in the audience that's wishing to speak in favor of this motion or in favor of this application? Anybody here to speak against this application? I don't think I had any sign of that. And anybody here just seeking more information? All right. Well then, I would entertain a motion to close the public hearing portion.
I can do that. That the public hearing for variance application V09-20 at 8 Winchester Drive be concluded.
And the seconder for that, Commissioner Boyd. All those in favor, that's closing the public hearing, thank you. Now, a motion regarding the variance.
I can do that also. That variance application V09-20 to vary table 10 under section 51 of the zoning bylaw to decrease the required front yard from 6.0 meters to 1.5 meters in the residential single detached zone be approved at 8 Winchester Drive. In accordance with the letter of intent attachment A1 and the site plan attachment B2, subject to the owner or successor providing written confirmation to the City of Brandon Development Services Division that arrangements have been made for the existing utility easements relocation to the satisfaction of Manitoba Hydro, Centre Gas, Manitoba, Bell MTS, and Westman Communication Groups. with all costs and expenses incurred in connection with the easement relocation being the sole responsibility of the owner of it or successor of the site.
Thank you. Do I have a seconder? Commissioner Hobson? Thank you. Commissioner Anderson, do you have anything to speak to?
I've got no issues with this, and the applicant has no issue with the requirement in regards to the utilities, so I'm in favor of this.
Thank you. Other commissioners, do you have comments? Yeah. No? Commissioner Hobson? No? All right. I don't have a problem. This house now does seem to be property line to property line to property line, but so be it. That's great. So with no other discussion?
Plus there's no no inquiries. No.
That's exactly what it is. Well, I would call the question then. All those in favor? That's all four. Thank you. Excellent. We'll move on to item D, the variance at 235 Glen Avenue. And I think, are we changing over a bit of the audience? Is there somebody in the... Okay. Oh.
Right. Okay. On the screen. Thank you again, Mr. Chair. So the next item is for a variance application at 235 Glen Avenue. So it's located in the North Hill part of the city, partway up between Braycrest Drive and the Trans-Canada Highway, about block west of First Street North. Zooming in more closely, it's at the northwest corner of the intersection of Glen Avenue, which runs east-west, and the combined street of White Swan Street and Charles Street, which you see there. So White Swan Street is the boundary between the mobile homes to the west and the commercial area to the east. The site is primarily commercial along First Street North, as I mentioned as well. This may be familiar to most of the Planning Commission members here tonight because we did deal with a successful rezoning of this site from commercial arterial to residential mobile home earlier this year. So there are mobile homes to the south and west of this site, and the Glendale Industries metal fabrication business to the north, as well as some other various commercial uses to the east of the site. This shows what the site currently looks like, or gives you a sampling of what the site currently looks like. It is fenced off with a 6-foot high chain link fence. The bottom right picture shows the neighboring use to the north, which is Glendale Industries. There has been some ongoing complaints from the existing mobile home park to the west of Glendale Industries about noise and dust in the area as a result of this use here. This photo shows the two properties. So to your left would be the proposed mobile home slash tiny home park that we dealt with the rezoning earlier this year, and Glendale Industries to the right. So the variance application is to increase the maximum height of a fence allowed from 1.8 meters to 2.5 along that shared property line that we just looked at in the photo. So due to already existing complaints and further concerns from the owner of Glendale Industries, the city did include a clause in the development agreement for the proposed mobile home park, requiring the owner of that park to construct a sound barrier between the two uses. This variance request is to increase the height of that said fence to 2.5 meters or 8 feet for those who are more familiar with imperial measurements in order to construct this required sound barrier. So this is the site plan showing again the proposed dwelling units on this site, and that site plan also indicates that there will be a sound barrier to the north of the site here, right on along the property line. So the proposal on its own may not necessarily be compatible with the neighborhood since all other fences are 1.8 meters or 6 feet in height, but that's a standard design height anyways. That said, it will fulfill the requirement of the development agreement, and it complies with the requests of the neighbors, both the residential and the industrial neighbors. So other than the variance that's being requested at hand, the proposal otherwise is compliant with all other provisions in the development plan and the zoning bylaw. So as of closing today, we did not receive any additional written concerns from the public. Mr. Chair.
Thank you. Commissioners, any questions regarding this to the administration?
I maybe have a comment, I don't know, through the chair.
Sure.
But we've had this happen before where we've had a business in a commercial or industrial zone, and then all of a sudden we have residential come in, and then they're not happy with the circumstances there, and then they want to change the business. And I really don't think that's fair, because the business was there first. I'm just thinking this, you know.
Through the chair to Commissioner Anderson, Brandon is not alone in dealing with incompatible land uses that are beside each other, often as a result of one of those uses at least being in existence for a longer period of time. It is a reality and an ongoing challenge that municipalities still face and are still trying to find the right balance, for lack of a better description.
Yeah.
And because each of these sites are very unique, there is no, you have to look at each situation on their own merits and determine what is the best way to address as many of these concerns as possible.
Thank you. Other questions for administration at this point? Thank you. Well, and we'll call upon the applicant then to come forward and present, or the applicants.
Good evening. My name is Kenny Choi. I'm the owner and applicant of this variance.
Mm-hmm.
My being here is that when we rezoned the property from commercial to residential mobile home park, one of the development agreement with the city of Brandon is that I will build a sound barrier between Glendale Industry and us. Since a normal fence is only 6 feet tall, this sound barrier needs to be 8 feet tall. And that's what the whole application is about. Thank you.
Thank you. Any commissioners have questions for Mr. Choi?
I'll ask Mr. Choi. Any issues with building the fence? No problem?
Well, I did lots of research through the internet.
Yeah.
As many, many ways you can do a sound barrier. On the highways, they use stones and cement. But since it's not a high volume noise area, and I noticed some of the streets and residential area, there are people has been using wood.
Mm.
And for the sound barrier, the trick is mass. That means between the sound and the other side for sound barrier, you've got to have a mass. Mass can be used with wood, rock, stone, or massive trees and shrubs. For us, the situation there, we propose to use mass, wood mass.
Okay.
Yeah, and we will use wood, and we'll make sure there will be no cracks or openings between the woods and 6 feet tall. So that it's quite effective, and they use it in many cities.
Good.
It's fine. Yeah.
Good. Thank you.
And it looked good.
Yeah, we want it to look good.
Yeah. Put cinder blocks in there.
Yeah.
Any other questions from the commissioners, Commissioner Boyd?
Through the chair to Mr. Choi. Yeah, we're well aware of the. We're well aware of the incident that this came back to the one that there was that sound barrier was the issue that was there before. And I think you've gone to a lot of work in trying to put this forward in the one to try and build it to 8 foot height to try and get that that buffer in there going through, and hopefully that works in this case. And you've reached an agreement with the neighbor where before with Glendale Industries, they weren't happy with the instance there before. It sounds like you've been able to reach that agreement with them that they're acceptable with this fence going into this one, and that's they're agreeable with that condition.
Well, in a way, you know, it's two-way street. He's worried about our tenants complaining about the noise coming from that Glendale industry. And also, I like to protect our tenants, that they have a peace and quiet environment. So this is extra cost. I offer to build some barrier to peace both sides of the people. And they will kind of accept the situation, and then we pass that rezoning bylaw. That's a win-win situation.
Great, thank you. Any other questions? Thank you, Mr. Troy.
Thank you.
Is there anybody present that wishes to speak also in favor of the application? Anyone looking to speak in opposition to the application?
I'm not sure if I'm in favor or if I'm in opposition.
Yeah. Please come forward and state your name and we'll...
I'm Janice Wiggins and I live in 105 Glendale Bay, which is right behind where he's proposing the development. Okay. So the very first mobile beside the playground. And I was at the last hearing and I was concerned about the trees. Mr. Choi has made several comments in regards to he was making a green development and he's looking at noise barriers. The trees that I want to save in Snowden's property, the property at 235, are old coniferous, probably 50-year-old trees that I'm presuming Mr. Snowden and Mrs. Snowden planted. I'd like to keep those trees, first off, because they're green development, green trees, and for sound barrier. Those trees provide a sound barrier to my place from Glendale Industries. The proposal that he's talking about talks only to the north side. There's a fence all the way along the west side, and noise comes through that chain link fence, and there's no proposal for anything there.
I was looking at the map again just so I could orient myself for your comments. Well, at this time, we may have to call back on administration with the client. We were only talking about the fence along the north boundary, and there was no discussion about taking out those trees. So I'm not quite clear what information you're seeking to...
Well, the boundary, he's only looking at a sound barrier on the mm-hmm. north side. Well, the sound doesn't just travel from the north side of that property. I mean, the fence of Glendale Industries goes all the way along the west side between Glen Avenue mm-hmm. all the way up to Clare Avenue. We're only talking about a fence on that one piece, that one little section. Yeah. What about the rest of the... And my piece, yeah. actually, that, you know, if I want to be self-centered, is that really the rest is Snowden's property on the west to that to the end of that one side.
So, again, we can really only address the application that's before us,
okay.
Which is that the altering the height of that fence. We don't really have a situation right now where we could talk about the fences that are off of this property.
Or even the
line of trees along that
on the west side of the
west side, because they aren't proposing to do anything that would require council permission on that side, right?
The trees are a different issue, mm-hmm. And I forget it's been a while since that last public hearing how it was addressed. But certainly with respect to the to any additional fencing along between Glendale Industries and the existing portion of Glendale Mobile Homes Park, it is a separate site, so that's why we're not dealing with it tonight. However, if the parties involved are amenable to that and the applicant wishes to, in the future, extend that sound barrier along the west side of Glendale Industries, they could also apply for a variance, height variance as well, just as they are doing tonight for the northern side of the site that we're dealing with tonight.
That it would be the west side?
Yes. So if the applicant wishes to address the sound on the west side of Glendale Industries, that would create an L-shaped fence then in the long term.
I don't know that I'm looking for a fence to be created. I'm looking for the trees to be saved as okay. The sound barrier that exists that I currently have from Glendale Industries. If he takes that out, then I'm going to have a sound issue.
Okay.
And again, unfortunately, from your perspective, I suspect that the commission doesn't really have much power over what people do or don't do with the trees on their property. And so in this sense, I don't know that this is actually giving you an opportunity to deal with that concern.
Well, I guess if it's a sound issue to the north, is it not a sound issue to the west? It kind of seems rather odd to me that you're only looking at going one direction.
I think the concern was more that the sound,
fence.
Well, the sound between the two adjacent properties. His property is not putting more noise into your backyard. You're just saying that right now, any noise that's coming across is also getting caught by those trees.
Yeah, so the trees right now protect me from the noise that he's looking to put a fence up on the north side, but if the trees are gone, am I still going to have?
Well, you will have some extra protection, I guess, from the one sound barrier.
Commissioner Chair, for clarification, now, are we talking about, or are you speaking to the one going through on the west side of Glendale Industries?
If you put the map back,
because the map showing the one that we're looking at is it's vacant right now, and that's where we're looking at Mini Home Park.
Yep. Now, are you looking behind that beside the playground, the very first mobile by the playground.
Okay, so you're actually looking at the west. So you're looking at the west side of that new development. Not the existing.
Can I use the mouse?
You might need to turn on the.
Yeah. I go on that one. Are you looking at the west side of this development, or are you looking at?
I'm right here.
Oh, okay.
So that's me. So right now, you see these trees. There's trees right here, and trees right here, and trees right there. So the fence line that he's proposing to put up there, at 8 feet, is fabulous. Don't get me wrong. I have no problem with that piece of it. But my concern is that if these trees come down, then I've got noise coming in because the noise comes through here.
I think what the administration was sort of getting to, again, is we don't really have a jurisdiction over telling him what to do or not to do with the trees. If you find that there's more noise here and you and perhaps your neighbors want to also have that sort of sound barrier built, that would have to be another request for a variance pressed from yourselves to build a fence, and whether that is done in any sort of cooperation with Mr. Choi or the industry, it's again not the commission's place to broker that. I feel we all hear your concerns. It's a matter that's not really within our purview at the moment because that's not what he's asking to do. If he was, it's sort of just part of a larger problem that this hearing isn't really addressing. So I apologize for that, because I know that you're coming out.
Like I said, I don't have a problem with the fence to the north. I just want to keep my trees in the sound barrier that I have to the west.
We are somewhat constrained ourselves by the legislation in terms of what we can decide on, right? We just can't keep moving along down the block.
And that's fine.
Through the chair, have you been told that your trees are going to come down?
I would presume that in that development that he's proposing that those trees will come down. He has said he would try to save some of them. I don't know that that's going to happen. I just know they're old trees, they're coniferous trees, they have a sound barrier, and if it's a green development, it makes logical sense to me that you keep green.
Thank you. Anybody else in the audience that wishes to speak either way? I don't think we have anyone else left. So I would then entertain the motion to close the public hearing. Do I have a motion to that effect? Commissioner Boyd?
I'll make a motion that the public hearing for variance application B-10-20 at 235 Glen Avenue be concluded.
And a seconder, Commissioner Anderson? All those in favor, That's all four. So that concludes the public hearing. And now then a motion for the variance.
I can do that as well.
Board.
Make a motion that the variance application V-10-20 to vary section 39A2 of the zoning bylaw by increasing the fence height in the required side yard from 1.8 meters to 2.5 meters along the north sight line in the residential mobile home zone be approved at 235 Glen Avenue in accordance with the letter of intent, attachments A1 and A2, and landscape plan, attachment B3.
Do you have a seconder? Commissioner Anderson? Commissioner Boyd, do you wish to speak to your...
Yes, I'd like to thank everyone for their presentations on this. I think there's been a good agreement has been reached between the occupants of Glendale Industries to the north and the applicant going forward to reach the conditions on this one with a sound barrier going through there and the city allowing them to increase the height from 6 feet to 8 feet. And with the other concern issue going along there that the presenter on that one is able to speak with the applicant to address maybe some concerns that they have along the west side of that one, but that's out of the purview of what we're discussing here tonight. And with that, I'll be looking at approving the applications for the variance application.
Commissioner Anderson, do you have anything to add?
I agree with Commissioner Boyd.
Commissioner Hobson, anything? No, and I agree. In fact, the question that Commissioner Anderson raised during the after the presentation from administration, the decision to make the land use change was really what that land use change choice was about. And once we did that, it sort of triggered this requirement for the sound barriers. So we're in many ways a sort of cleaning up a series of events that we initiated in ourselves in a way. So I'll also be supporting it. So all those in favor of the variance, that's all four. Thank you, Mr. Choi. You've got your variance. And that brings us then just to item E, which is an extension of a conditional use. And
yes, there is no presentation with this, no. So if it's all right, I'll yep. just speak from Thank my you. Position here. Mr. Chair, this, again, most of the Planning Commission members here would have dealt with this last year, back in July. There was a conditional use application to build a three dwelling unit buildings on a site known as 1334 on 7th Street. So the original did get approval, but the project has been delayed for financial reasons. So they are requesting an extension to the conditional use decision approval, so that they have more time to secure necessary funding to begin working on their project as soon as possible. This is why we have this item back with us tonight, Mr.
Thank
Chair.
You. Thank you much. And I understand we have Mr. Olson present. Do you wish to address the commission on anything, or
if somebody has any questions, I'd be more than happy to. But
well, then I'll.
I don't mind.
I'll just put it to the commission. Do we have any questions, Mr. Olson?
All right. Just the only one question I have through the chair to the administration that this meets all requirements going through. The request came through within the time frame of the year to allow for the extension request. And
sorry, through the chair. Say that again, please.
This meets all the criteria going through with the request for the extension. The application came forward in time to meet all the conditions of the request.
Yeah, through the chair to Commissioner Boyd. Yes, they did meet the requirements to ask for this extension.
Good. Yeah, thank you. And I would just say to Mr. Olson, thank you for coming out. We've had extension requests in the past where the commission has had questions and the applicant hasn't come, and so this was thank you for coming. Fortunately, we didn't have any hard pressing questions for you, but we appreciate you.
Yeah.
Better to show than not.
Yes, thank you. So then I would seek a motion closing the public hearing for this extension.
Commissioner. I can do that. That the public hearing for extension of conditional use C04-19 at 1334 7th Street be concluded.
Thank you. A seconder? Commissioner Hobson? All those in favor? That's all four of us, so that closes the public hearing. And now a motion to approve the deadline to July 24th.
I can do that also.
Great, Commissioner Anderson.
That the approval deadline of conditional use decision C-04-19 be extended to July 24th, 2021.
And a seconder for that, Commissioner Hodson. Any comments, Commissioners?
Nope.
Right? No. All right, call the question. All those in favor? That's all four. Thank you. So you got your extension.
Thanks for coming here.
Well, I even brought a tie-dye mask. I was going
to smile. Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you guys very much.
Yeah. Good luck with the project.
So that brings us to general business and the tracking table. Oh, you stopped recording?
Yes.
Okay, thank you. Does the administration have anything to comment on the tracking table or the?
We've got a few items coming down the pipe for the Planning Commission, but first, next council meeting on August the 10th. We just got an update today. The flat secondary plan we originally were targeting for August 10th, that is not possible. We are deferring that to September. But just to give you a heads up, we are looking at moving forward with a new secondary plan for the northern area. Actually, we originally were naming it the Flats, but we've renamed it since then to Assiniboine Gardens.
Nice.
It's more of a historically more appropriate for this area, actually, when we did our further research. Some items that went through public hearings last month are going for second and some even for third reading as well later on at this council meeting. So the 10th Street sixplex proposal, the 18th Street four-story development near the stone fence, amongst others. Let's see here. Moving ahead to September, so no more items for Planning Commission until September 16th. So
oh, okay.
September 16th is our next meeting.
Is our next meeting, that is correct.
Okay.
So again, obviously the secondary plan is not going ahead there, but we are anticipating one item that will likely help keep this room pretty full, 1230 on 18th Street North, southwest corner of 18th and Bray Cross.
John Booker?
Yes, or I forget if he owns the site now, but it was the John Hooker site that the Planning Commission has dealt with contentiously a couple years ago.
Yeah. Do we need a reminder about NIMBYs?
How so? Sorry, through the chair.
In terms of not in my backyard.
I just remember after we had that that meeting, I think, was it Trudy?
Sandy Trudell, yes.
Yes, she came in and gave us a very good talk on it, which was very informative. If she had a pamphlet we could read or whatever, just to keep everybody informed or whatever.
Is this just a question of remaining focused on what we can and cannot decide upon, rather than the concerns that the public sometimes bring forward that we can't give any weight to? Is that the...
That is one way of looking at it. Another way is also trying to discern whether some of their concerns being raised are legitimate, or is there, for lack of a better description, an ulterior motive.
Mm-hmm.
Especially, I don't want to muddy the waters because it's told, but it is pretty relevant in our current time frame that we're living in now. One example is the question of systemic racism, and actually there has been some recent written works in the planning world where they have identified some forms of NIMBYism is an extension of systemic racism, but that's heavy.
Are you reaching there?
It's heavy reading, but what Amber and I could do is see if we could follow up with Sandy and see if she can provide us that information again.
Yeah.
And we can follow up with this planning commission on that.
Yeah.
And,
good.
And maybe when we see the report, if the commissioners have any concerns about what matters are sort of falling under our purview and which aren't, we can maybe even talk about that a little bit by email. The other ones on the 16th are fairly straightforward.
Let's see. Yeah, so Southview Drive, that is a rear yard variance request for a sunroom into the backyard. It's a bit of a pie-shaped lot, so it's again a bit of an odd situation, not a straight rectangular lot. 2505 McDonald Avenue, that's another conditional use for another four-unit development. So on the property just east of one that this planning commission dealt with just a couple months ago.
Oh, okay.
And 1045 on 2nd Street, it doesn't ring a bell right now, but I don't recall any of the, I only recall that the one most contentious item would be the 18th Street North application.
But maybe some of those residents have moved. It's been a few years.
Well, we'll see.
Things change.
And again, yeah, we should take every application at its face value at the time and not necessarily try to fix. I always think of that. There's that one TV commercial where the referee comes up and says, I really screwed up last time, so I'm gonna rule twice in favor of the other team. But we can't really do that. If there's history, we need to look at what we're at right now and all.
Blew that call on the first house. On the second half, I'll straighten it out, right?
Yeah. All right. So is there anything then for other administrative business?
Not from our end. And
okay. And we see this format carrying on for the near future, I suppose. We're not really seem to be getting any other direction. Do we know of any absences? September 16th is a month away, but
should be okay.
Yeah, it actually rings a bell for me, so I'm gonna have to take a look, but it should be okay. Yeah, excellent. Then I think we're okay to move to adjourn. Good, thank you. I think we've adjourned.
All right.
Sorry, that was Commissioner Anderson and Commissioner Boyd, I think, were the ones that had their hands up fastest. Thank you. Thank you, Amber, for that.
Andrew, I've been meaning to ask, how are the new washrooms downtown doing? Are they open with COVID?
Good.
That's a good question.